Welcome to Smart News Digital, dated 27th September 2018. So these are the articles which we are going to see today in detail. The most awaited Aadhaar judgment is delivered by Supreme Court yesterday. Ever since a 9-judge bench that unanimously ruled privacy as a fundamental right, opinions began to gain ground that unique identification program is vulnerable to judicial scrutiny. Following that, in yesterday's judgment, Supreme Court backed the Aadhaar as document of empowerment and upholds the passage of Aadhaar Act as a money bill, backing Section 7 that allows Aadhaar to avail the government benefits, subsidies for which the government has to incur money from the Consolidated Fund of India. So for which Aadhaar Act has been regarded as the money bill. And next one is Aadhaar as a reasonable restriction on individual privacy. Minimal biometric information can only be taken and it did not amount to right to privacy. Also, it stated that it fulfills the government's legitimate aim to provide dignity to a large marginalized population living in abject poverty. The government has also stated that taking Aadhaar into account, it will be a transformative scheme for providing benefits to the poor and marginalized. This was justified by the Supreme Court that technology had now become a vital tool for ensuring good governance in a social welfare state. The Supreme Court also mandated that the Aadhaar is not necessary for children aged between 6 and 14 under the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, as the right to education was a fundamental right. So based on this, the government cannot ask for Aadhaar card for enrollment. The court also directed the government to bring in remedies to plug the loopholes rather than axing Aadhaar. To justify this, Justice Chandrachud have commented that we cannot throw the baby out with bathwater. Also, the Supreme Court sought to bring in regulations to prevent rightfully entitled people from being denied benefits. They have also purported it as a surveillance state, creating a risk to the privacy of the individual. Countering this, the Supreme Court judgment have stated that the authentication transactions through Aadhaar did not ask for the purpose or nature or location of the transactions. Also, the Aadhaar structure makes it very difficult to create the profile of a person. So there won't be any duplication like that in case of passports, PAN cards and ration cards. In this case, we are now going to see the inclusions and exclusions of the Aadhaar Act. What the Aadhaar judgment means for the citizen. Private companies, mobile phone connections and bank accounts does not need Aadhaar anymore to be linked to their accounts. Also, for schooling exams like NEET, UGC and CBSE, JEE, Aadhaar is not mandatory for enrollment in the examinations. Only it is essential to link the Aadhaar with a PAN card. Duplication of PANs may be dealt with more systematic and foolproof manner with the use of the high-end technologies. Also, the school admissions can no more insist on Aadhaar for admissions. The Aadhaar structure makes it very difficult to create the profile of a person. In this regard, collection of personal data and its authentication can only be done through registered devices. Also, the authority doesn't get any information regarding IP address or GPS locations for transactions. In this way, the structure makes it difficult to get duplicated. Also, the Supreme Court has quashed several provisions in the present Aadhaar Act, in which authentication records should not be retained for more than 6 months, and declared the archiving of records for 5 years as bad in law. And also, the Supreme Court prohibited the creation of a metabase for transactions because creating a metabase will have security and surveillance issues. It also quashed the Section 33(1) of the Aadhaar Act, which allows the disclosure of Aadhaar information on the orders of a district judge. This cannot be done without giving the concerned person an opportunity to be heard. So the court has quashed Section 33 Clause 2 of the Aadhaar Act, which stated disclosure of Aadhaar information for national security reasons on the orders of an officer not below a joint secretary level. Officers above the joint secretary level have to consult the district judge and unanimously decide whether it shall be revealed in case of the national interest. The Supreme Court also quashed Section 47 of the Aadhaar Act, which provides that only the UIDAI to file criminal complaints of the Aadhaar data breach, which means that anyone can take up the complaint if there is any breach in the Aadhaar data protections. As I have already told that private companies are no more allowed to use Aadhaar data to authenticate a person. This is justified by the court by quashing Section 57 of the Aadhaar Act. As the court has quashed to link Aadhaar with SIM cards, now it is becoming difficult to delete this biometric data which have been already procured. But the bone of contention here is a circular was issued by the Department of Telecommunications mandating that linking of mobile numbers with Aadhaar. Now the government is supposed to delete the personal data that has been linked to the SIM cards. The biometric information that have been linked by the SIM cards poses grave threats to individuals' privacy and liberty and autonomy. As of now, the recorded data cannot be deleted because it takes a tedious process. As the stored biometric data is difficult to delete, now the information shall not be used by any agency or on their behalf. Now we shall see the second article, Aadhaar Survives. In this, the author claimed that Aadhaar is possibly too big to fail. He says that Supreme Court has taken a stand of a pragmatic middle path between the Aadhaar scheme's excesses and its benefits to the marginalized. Also, the Aadhaar judgment narrows the scope and provides a framework within which it can work efficiently. Just because of 0.24% of the authentication failure, the Aadhaar cannot be struck down as it is supporting and favoring 99.76% of the people who can be claimed as the beneficiaries. The author justifies the Aadhaar Act as it passes the triple test. The first one being, there should be a law wherein which the privacy should not be abridged. And the second one is the legitimate state interest, that the states aim to proceed with the welfare schemes for the beneficiaries. Also the third one as an element of proportionality, wherein which there is a balancing act of safeguarding privacy on one hand and benefiting the people on the other hand. Now we shall see the third article, Opacity in the Name of Privacy. The Sri Krishna Committee proposed draft Personal Data Protection Bill poses a danger to the hard-won right to information. In the proposed draft bill, the term personal data mentions about the data that are directly or indirectly identifies a person. This draft bill has called for an amendment of Clause 81J of the Right to Information Act 2005. In this clause 81J of RTI Act, it states that the personal information which could cause unwarranted invasion of privacy or it has no relationship with public activity or interest of the public, it shall not be revealed. But if you see, the RTI Act's core aim is to bring accountability by making available public records that disclose the political class and bureaucracy related matters. In the name of personal data, the bill defines harm expansively to include everything from blackmail and bodily injury to loss of reputation, humiliation and mental injury, which poses a threat to RTI Act. Also, the bill ignores the another key aim of the RTI Act, that is containing corruption. If you see, revealing information about corruption is a public interest, but this bill ignores the key aim of the RTI Act containing corruption in the name of safeguarding people's privacy. Also, if you see, a negative thing about this amended clause is that the public information officers who are supposed to reveal the personal data informations in regard of the public interest, will now have a strong legal ground to play safe, backing on this proposed draft protection bill and toss out the RTI requests. Apart from this, a powerful provision in this bill is that the information, that is the personal information, which shall not be denied to state or a parliament, shall not be denied to any individual also. But this provision is put under threat by the Supreme Court in the case Girish Deshpande versus CIC 2012, wherein which the Supreme Court upheld the asserts and details about the performance of a public servant which constituted as a personal information are exempted from disclosing. This again prompts PIOs to profusely abuse the privacy exemption under RTI Act, citing the Clause 81J and 2012 Supreme Court ruling as the grounds for denial. So the Supreme Court judge has stated that misusing of Clause 81J of the RTI Act is rampant and is reducing the RTI to a mockery, for which the citizens are liable to urge the government to not to amend the RTI Act. Now we shall see the fourth article, that is G4 countries pitching for multilateralism and Security Council reforms. In the United Nations General Assembly meeting, Trump has accused UN Human Rights Council and ICC. He says that America shall be governed by only Americans. In the name of embracing patriotism, he rejects the ideology of globalism, for which, responding to this comment of Trump, India and other G4 countries, that is Japan, Germany and Brazil, reaffirmed their commitment to multilateralism. If you see, Germany and Japan contribute 1/5 of the UN budget and all the four put together constitute 1/5 of the world's population. For which the G4 countries stressed that adapting the UN to the contemporary needs of the 21st century, for which the UN Security Council have to go for reformation. If you could see, US has no active opposition to consider these four countries as the permanent members of the UNSC, but it is China which is slowing down the process of reformation in the UN Security Council. Even though the negotiations started in 2009, it had not produced any substantive progress over 10 years. So these G4 countries pitched to revitalize the process of the UN Security Council reforms, and they tasked their respective officials to consider the way forward to advance the reform. In this way, these G4 countries have shown their unity and stressed for multilateralism and Security Council reforms. Now the fifth article is boost to SC/ST quota in promotions. The Supreme Court has held that there is no need to collect quantifiable data for promotions in reservation for SC/ST in the government jobs. If you see, in the Nagaraj case of 2006, the states were bound to provide quantifiable data on the backwardness of SC and ST. If you see, this Nagaraj case of 2006 is conflicting with the former Indrasani verdict in 1992, wherein which the Supreme Court held that there is no need of test for SCs and STs to back the social and economic backwardness, because the SCs and STs are indubitably falling under the ambit of backward class of citizens. So what's next? The judgment will give a fillip to the government to accelerate the promotions with consequential seniority for SCs and STs in government services. Now the sixth article is the government report stating that recyclers storing e-waste hazardously. If you see, the firms that are registered as recyclers are only dismantling and leaving the waste without any processing. To overcome this issue, in 2017, the center has brought into effect the e-waste rules, wherein which the electronic companies are supposed to collect a certain percentage of e-waste generated from their goods once they have achieved their end of life. If this has been effectively followed by the electronic companies, they were supposed to have collected 10% by within 2017 and 18. This would have raised to 70% by 2023, and that considerably reduces the improper management of the electronic wastes. Doing this would require these firms to work with licensed e-waste recyclers and ensure that all e-waste is properly disposed of. And what is the way forward for this issue is taking up the recycling and reusing processes effectively. If you see, after collecting the e-waste manually, it has to be taken into the shredding and granulation process and then to the magnetic and eddy current separation, and thereby forming the base metals, plastic pellets and processed glass that can be reused in various components. Also, this issue can be resolved by proactive participation of the CPCB, that is the Central Pollution Control Board, and the State Pollution Control Boards. They are empowered to check whether recycling agencies are complying with the rules. Thank you.